Today's reading is from 1 Corinthians 12, verses 1 through to 31. Now, about the gifts of the Spirit, brothers and sisters, I do not want you to be uninformed. You know that when you were pagans, somehow or other, you were influenced and led astray to mute idols. Therefore, I want you to know that no one who is speaking by the Spirit of God says Jesus be cursed, and no one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. There are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit distributes them. There are different kinds of service, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of working, but in all of them, and in everyone, it is the same God at work. Now to each one, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. To one there is given through the Spirit a message of wisdom. To another, a message of knowledge by means of the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by that one Spirit. To another, miraculous powers. To another, prophecy. To another, distinguishing between spirits. To another, speaking in different kinds of tongues. And to still another, the interpretation of tongues. All of these are the work of one and the same Spirit, and he distributes them to each one just as he determines. Just as a body, though one, has many parts, but all its many parts form one body, so it is with Christ. For we were all baptized by one Spirit so as to form one body, whether Jews or Gentiles, slave or free, and we were all given the one Spirit to drink. Even so, the body is not made up of one part, but of many. Now, if the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason stop being part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason stop being part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? If the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? But in fact, God has placed the parts in the body, every one of them, just as he wanted them to be. If they were all one part, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, but one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I don't need you. And the head cannot say to the feet, I don't need you. On the contrary, those parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And the parts that we think are less honourable, we treat with special honour. And the parts that are unpresentable are treated with special modesty, while our presentable parts need no special treatment. But God has put the body together, giving greater honour to the parts that lacked it, so that there should be no division in the body, but that its parts should have equal concern for each other. If one part suffers, every part suffers with it. If one part is honoured, every part rejoices with it. Now you are the body of Christ, and each one of you is a part of it. And God has placed in the church, first of all apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then miracles, then gifts of healing, of helping, of guidance, and of different kinds of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all have gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? Now eagerly desire the greater gifts. And yet I will show you the most excellent way.
Well, we continue in our series, A Place to Belong. We've seen already that church is a group of people, a family, who love one another because we've first been loved by God in the Lord Jesus. Then last week we saw that church was a family that gathered together to encourage one another as God presenced himself with us. And today we're going to see church as a family gifted by God's Spirit to serve one another. So let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, we this morning come to you not just physically in different places, but we come spiritually in different places, we come emotionally in different places, and we come to your word, Lord, and we want to hear from you. Lord Jesus, by your Spirit, speak into our hearts. Speak truth, speak love. Please, Lord Jesus, move us that we might understand more the joy, the privilege, the wonder of being a part of your body for your name's sake. Amen. Well, life is not about me, it's about us. We're in it together. I think the COVID crisis has sort of shown us that, hasn't it? I mean, back in March 2020, when things kicked off, people were dropping notes round to their neighbours to offer to buy them shopping. We all got out on our doorstep or to the end of our drive to clap our NHS workers. But as the crisis has gone on, well, that's just got a little bit harder. I think now probably most people are weary. We're struggling just to keep going ourselves. There's lots of talk about the mental health issues involved. And as that's happened, we've thought more and more about me and less about us. Yeah, there's lots of care ongoing in the community, but in the end, living life about us rather than me, it's just hard work. And that's because the final thing is that our own natural heartbeat is that life is about me. Ever since the fall, when people chose to reject God, we've believed that a life that's centered on me is really the life of happiness. It's about what I do and who I am and I getting to be what I want. Now that, sadly, can even infect the church. And that was what was happening in the church in Corinth. They turned the Christian life to being about me. So they thought, well, church, it's about how it makes me feel and who's my favorite preacher. Well, you can see that in 1 Corinthians 1. Oh, you know, I really like Peter. He's at the big church in Jerusalem, but luckily you can get his sermons on podcast. Or do you remember when Apollos was here? Oh, those were the good old days with Apollos. But fortunately, he's on what my mother calls the YouTube, and you can still listen to him. What about Paul? Well, you know, he's okay, but he does keep going on about the Christian life being hard work. It was about their favorite teachers, how they made them feel. And it was also about how spiritual they were. Did they have gifts that they felt helped them? And that's what chapter 12, the chapter we had read, is all about. Now look at what Paul says in verse 1. He's answering a letter that they've written to him. Now about the gifts of the Spirit, brothers and sisters, I do not want you to be uninformed. Or more literally, now about the spirituals. This word, the spirituals, appears to be the word they used in Corinth, and they loved it. It was all about how they needed more of the Spirit to feel good about themselves. They loved talking about needing more of the miraculous, more of the special in their church. The problem was their thinking about the Holy Spirit was driving a wedge right through the middle of the church. So right at the outset, Paul reminds them that anyone who follows Jesus has his Spirit. Do you see that in verse 3? Therefore, I want you to know that no one who is speaking by the Spirit of God says, Jesus be cursed, and no one can say, Jesus is Lord, except by the Holy Spirit. Having Jesus as your Lord, that's the mark that God's Spirit is within you. Now, you might need to hear that this morning. Maybe you've recently become a Christian, or maybe you've been a Christian for a number of years, and you've just thought, you know what, I'm lacking something. I mean, I look at all those smiley, happy people out there in the church, well, smiley on the outside anyway, and they seem to have something more than me. Well, the thing you need to hear is, if you're a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, God promises that the very presence of your Father in heaven, your precious Savior Jesus, he dwells in your heart by his Holy Spirit, and he will never leave you or forsake you. Paul wants that right up front. That's what Corinthians need to hear. And then he spends the rest of the chapter outlining to them how God then has given gifts through his Spirit to all Christians, different gifts, so they can serve each other. And they're not about me, they're about us. You see, here's the first thing. God has given us different gifts for the common good. Look at verse 4 with me. There are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit distributes them. It's a different word for gifts here. It's the word charismata, grace gifts. This is Paul's word. Gifts and of abilities from God purely because of his undeserved love for his precious church. They're all gifts about doing the work of the Lord Jesus. Different gifts for one common purpose. It comes in verse 7. Now to each one, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. For the common good. The Spirit is visibly at work in the life of every Christian, giving them gifts and ability so that they can use that gift for the sake of everyone else in the church. Now, Paul emphasizes how people have different gifts by giving a list. It comes in verse 8. There's a really important word missed in our translations. Why don't you look down at your Bible while I read and I'll put the word in. Verse 8. To one there is given through the Spirit a message of wisdom, but to another a message of knowledge by means of the same Spirit. To another faith by the same Spirit, but to another gifts of healing by that one Spirit. Do you see how Paul is emphasizing different people have different gifts? This isn't supposed to be a shopping list of what you would like, a spiritual gifts shopping list, or even a list to compare yourself to so you can see what you might have. There are lots of different lists of gifts of the Spirit in the New Testament. None of them are complete. We know that. There's no gift of music mentioned anywhere, no gift of worship leading mentioned anywhere in the Bible, but clearly that's something that God gifts people to do. No, this is simply a list of the things that are going on in the church in Corinth. And here's the punchline. It comes in verse 11. All of these are the work of one and the same Spirit, and he distributes them to each one just as he determines. He chooses the gifts he gives to different people. Now, the really sad thing is that people over the years have divided about these verses just in the same way as the Corinthians were. They suggested, for instance, that everyone should speak in tongues. I mean, all you need to do is just confess your sin more, or maybe you just need to ask harder and you'll have the gift of tongues. Or maybe you need to look at this list and try and work out what each one of them is and see how you can get the gift that you particular want. But those things aren't true. But Paul's whole point is that every Christian has already been given a gift through the Spirit of God to serve others. That means no one is more spiritual than anyone else, and no one is less spiritual than anyone else. When we get to verse 28, we'll see that the gift of helping other people is just as spiritual as the gift of healing other people. Now, dividing about gifts of the Spirit is absolutely the opposite of what the Spirit wants us to do. Because secondly, we see the Spirit is the way that God has made us one body by his Spirit. Look at verse 12 with me. Just as one body, though one has many parts, but all its parts form one body, so it is with Christ. Christ here refers to his body on earth, his people, the church. Now, it's vital we understand in the Bible that church isn't a building like the one I'm standing in this morning, nor is church a denomination, say, like the Church of England, may God bless all who sail in her, or church is, say, an event like we're doing church, it's 10 o'clock, it's live stream Sunday, and shortly after 11, church will end. No, church in the Bible is God's people gathered together around Jesus and his word by the power of his Holy Spirit. It's a family or a household, and that's the way it's described. Church is about our relationship with Jesus and therefore our relationship with each other. I mean, I'm in my family wherever I am, whether I like it or not. You know, when I walk out the door of our house, I don't leave my family, however hard I slam the door. And the same is with church. Wherever I am, I'm part of this church family at St. James, in Tesco's, walking the dog, whether I'm at home. Why? Well, look at what Paul says in verse 13. For we were all baptized by one Spirit so as to form one body, whether Jews or Gentiles, slave or free, and we were all given the one Spirit to drink. Baptism in the Spirit is another way of talking about what Jesus does for us when we come to follow him. There's no special ceremony to go through. There's no second blessing to get. When we turn from our sins and believe in Jesus Christ, the promise of the Bible is that he pours out his Spirit into our lives. And then he unites us together as one body. Now, when you think of your body, you don't think of it like a set of component parts, do you? It's not like one of those avatars you make on a computer game. You don't get to choose the different bits. I mean, it's not that mum and dad, say, went down to the body department at the local hospital and went, yeah, we'd like those arms, the long, hairy ones. And could we have that head? Got anything less ugly? No, sorry, okay, we'll do with that. And we were wondering, have you got anything in the brain department that's on special offer this week? You're not a set of component parts. You're you. When you think about you think about your whole person. And Paul says that's the same with the church. That's simply who we are. You are one. That's the way God's made you. He's bound you together as one by his Spirit, whatever your previous background, however much you might have looked down upon other people who are now in your church. And in Paul's day, no one was more divided than the Jew or the Gentile, the slave or the free. But now, he says, God's bound you together by his Spirit as one body, as a family. Now we see that at St. James, don't we? Different people from different backgrounds, different cultures, living sometimes in different places, bound together by the Spirit of God as one. It's why people leaving a church is such agony. It literally leaves wounds. Church division is like a body being torn apart. It breaks hearts. It causes pain. In fact, Paul says, God has given us these gifts of the Spirit to unite us. That's the third thing to see. God's different gifts that he's given us are so that everyone is needed. Everyone is needed. That's Paul's point in verses 15 to 20. What he's trying to do is reassure that person who's thinking, look, I just don't belong here. These aren't my people. Look what he says using the illustration of the body in verse 15. Now, if the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason stop being part of the body. Or he goes on, for the ear and the eye. I mean, can you imagine your foot saying, well, I don't feel I'm much needed around here. I mean, it's not like you've used me much. You've hardly ever got up out of this sofa. I've got nothing to do. I just don't belong. It sounds ridiculous, doesn't it? But you and I know that when we feel that we don't belong in a church, it's a really painful experience. And maybe that's you today. Maybe you feel it. You're just not needed at St. James. Well, look, says Paul, the reality is you are indispensable. I mean, can you imagine a body with no variety? I mean, can you imagine if your whole body was just one giant eye? Apart from being pretty scary, what would you do for hearing? And so Paul says, God has put you exactly where he wants you, in this church family. And he's given you gifts by his Spirit that make you totally indispensable to us. God wants you to know that you're a vital part of his local church. Because the body of Christ, it only has vital parts. There's no appendix in the Christian body. We're all desperately needed. But there's another group Paul wants to address. It's not those who are struggling to belong. It's those who may be looking down on others. And this is what he said. It's our last point. God's given different gifts, so we need everyone. Look at verse 21 with me. The eye cannot say to the hand, oh, I don't need you. And the head cannot say to the feet, I don't need you. I mean, it's ridiculous again, isn't it? You know, the eye saying to the hand, I'm off. You're useless. Why do I need you? And the hand replying, well, just wait till you get a bit of grit in you and see how well you do then. Maybe these are the spirituals of verse 1. They think that they're so strong in the Lord, they feel they don't need some of those weak people at St. James Corinth. Anyway, going to church recently for them, it's not given them the usual buzz. They've not felt so built up, and Well, they're spiritual people, so the problem can't be with them. It must be with everyone else. So what they're going to do is they're going to take some time off church, or they're going to find another church with people who are just as spiritual as they are. Well, that's not the case, is it? But Paul says, look at verse 22. On the contrary, those parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. God's ordered the church so everyone is needed, however strong or weak they might seem. I think it's so easy for us, isn't it, to get into the habit of thinking that what God wants the church to look like is to be full of smiley, happy, successful, sort of spiritually on fire people. We buy into that whenever we get a sports personality up who's a Christian or a successful business person. It's as though we're saying, well, look, Jesus, he's not very attractive, but fortunately, this TV personality, they follow Jesus, and they can make him look good. But listen to what Paul says about who God chooses to put in his church in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. It's verse 27. But God chooses the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chooses the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God chooses the lowly things of this world and the despised things. We can't look down on other Christians. No, God has chosen the very weak and despised things to put them into his family. At our previous church, we were privileged to have a number of people in the congregation who had learning difficulties. And there is nothing more spiritually encouraging than turning up on a Sunday morning and Colin, as usual, being in the front row because he's keen, unlike all the other people, being in the front row, and he's there, and he's dancing, usually to some old hymn, and he's dancing, and he does not hit one beat of the music, but he is always full of joy. And he was indispensable. But Paul pushes this analogy of body parts a little bit further. He goes maybe and talks about things that in polite Gerard's Cross society we don't mention in public. Look at verse 23. All teenage boys are now listening. Verse 23. And the parts that are unpresentable are treated with special modesty, while our presentable parts need no special treatment. I mean, perhaps you feel like an unpresentable part of the body. You're hanging around on the fringes, you're vulnerable, you feel like you might be a bit embarrassing to people, you were last needed 20 years ago, but maybe you're ashamed of what you've done. Well, Paul says, God's poured his spirit into you as well. He's given you an ability to serve others. We need you. That's the way God has made his church. So, verse 25, so that there should be no division in the body, that its parts should have equal concern for each other. You see, a sign of a spirit-filled church isn't how many people speak in tongues. And don't get me wrong, I pray privately in tongues myself. But it's not how many people speak in tongues or how many healings there are or how rocking the music is. No, a sign of a spiritually filled church is how much the people have a deep, loving concern for one another. A love for every member of the body that, according to verse 26, means that if one part suffers, every part suffers with it. If one part is honored, every part rejoices with it. Such a beautiful thing when God's people love each other like that. Or when they drop a card or some flowers around to someone who they don't really know that well, but they've heard that they've been bereaved and, hey, they're part of the St. James Church family. Or when they go around with a meal or say congratulations to someone who's just had a baby and they've not really ever talked to them before, but they're part of the same church family. You see, that's an extraordinary thing. And Paul emphasizes this unity in verse 27. He says, now you are the body of Christ. Each one of you is part of it. Not you must become the body of Christ, or you must try harder. You are. You're united, but you're different, he says. Again, he rubs that in by asking seven questions in the next couple of verses, the expected answer of which is all no. Are you all apostles? No, obviously. I'm not an apostle, Paul. Are you all prophets? No. Are you all teachers? No. Do all work miracles? No. Do all have gifts of healing? No. Do all speak in tongues? No. Do all interpret? No, we've all got different gifts. Different gifts given by God, by His Spirit, for the benefit of the whole church. That means everyone is needed, and we need everyone. So just as I finish, here are a couple of things to think about. Mixed up, messy, St. James, Gerrard's Cross and Fulmer is a supernatural community brought together by the Spirit of God. And frankly, that's a miracle. Here's the second thing. Mixed up, messy, you and me are indispensable to our church family. However weak you feel, however ashamed you feel, however much you feel if we really knew you, we wouldn't want you here. We need you. Because God has given you a gift to serve us and to build us up and to encourage us. Now, the key thing is not to sort of select what gift you want. It's to come and to serve. That's why small groups are so important, those growth groups, because we can know people's life and reality and we can love them as a result. You might want to come on the Connect course if you're feeling disconnected. One of the things we look at is how we can use our gifts to serve God and serve His people. Here's the next thing. If we need everyone, and everyone is needed, that means that if we're not that committed to our church family, if we're not that committed to serving and loving them, that's really quite an arrogant thing. We're effectively saying, I don't need you. You know, in fact, more than that, if God in His wisdom has put us into a church family because we all need each other, we're saying, hey God, I think you got that wrong. You got that wrong, Lord. I can fly solo with Jesus. And that's just not true. I think that's why a lot of us are struggling spiritually during lockdown. I found myself listening to music from our last church, which was the last time I got together with a group of people, and weeping this week because I just missed so much being amongst God's people and singing His praises like that. It's a dreadfully arrogant thing to say, I don't need to go to church this week. I'm doing fine. But it's also a selfish thing. Because if God's given me gifts for the whole of the church, and I'm not willing to go on a rota or a team to use them in His service because maybe I need to keep that Sunday free because, you know, I might want to go cycling or do something really spiritual like that, well, that's just being selfish. I'm not loving my brothers and sisters. You see, church isn't an a la carte restaurant, you know, where you order what you want off the spiritual menu. You have your own particular tastes. Church isn't a service station where you go when you need a bit of a spiritual top-up, and if you don't feel you need it, you don't need to go. No, church is a family, a body. I mean, can you imagine saying to Granny when she invites you around to lunch, I'm not hungry, Granny, I'm not coming. Or, I don't feel I need to experience your love this week, Granny, so I'm just not going to show up. No, it's a body. We've been united by God's Spirit in love to serve one another with the gifts He gives us. And it's beautiful when that happens. It's beautiful when you see a family who invite in a guy. He was a guy with mental health difficulties. He was actually incontinent. And they let him sleep on their sofa for a few weeks because he's got nowhere else to go. And I loved coming in and seeing the seven-year-old, to the mother's horror, sitting on the sofa with this bloke under the duvet watching the telly. It's beautiful when you see the powerful executive who's living in the same three-bed semi, who's brought his three kids up in it, the same semi they bought when they first got married, because he wants to remain a part of that church family God's put him in. And he wants to serve in the kids' work like he always has done. And he's given a ridiculous proportion of his salary to gospel work. In fact, on gifts of the Spirit, that's one I've never been asked to pray for. No one has ever come up to me and said, Daff, I think I'm a bit tight and stingy. I'm only giving 5% of my gross income. Could you pray that I'd have the gift of giving? I've never been asked to pray for that. I don't know why. The beauty of seeing a single person give up about half their annual holiday to go and help some teenagers understand about Jesus on a Christian camp when they could be off seeing the world. The beauty of a young family, I remember this, setting aside their day off to take a local guy who was on benefits and really struggling to the seaside for the first time he'd been there in years. The teenagers had learned more about the love of God that day than from any sermon I gave them. But the beauty of just simply picking up the phone and calling an older person who's struggling in lockdown. Now these are the gifts of the Spirit I long to have. Because they're not about me. They're about us. Shall we pray that we be a church filled with God's Spirit, using our gifts as He has given them to us, that we might not be about me, but about us? Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, oh, we thank you that the Lord Jesus has poured out His Spirit upon us. Lord, maybe more in lockdown than any other time, we feel that we just could not keep going unless, Holy Spirit of God, you were in us and you were keeping us clean to Jesus. And we thank you that you've given us gifts, all of us. Oh, please, Lord, help us to use what you've given us to serve our church family, our brothers and sisters in Christ. Lay upon our hearts all you would have us do. And as we do that, would we build one another up in Christ? And would we look a little bit more like a family that loves you as you have loved us, for Jesus' name's sake? Amen.